At this point, you're probably no stranger to the countless articles of how AI is gonna steal our jobs, take over the world, and end life as we know it. That stuff's not really important to me, though. What I care about is if it can become the very best, like no one ever was. Say hello to ChatGPT, the AI that we're gonna use to take on the Hoenn region in a classic Nuzlocke. So, Mr. GPT, what's our first goal?
First, you have to give yourself a name. Then save the professor north of Little Root Town. Pick Torchic and name it something quirky and unique, like Hot Wing. Go fight Mei on Route 103. Then you'll get Pokeballs and the Nuzlocke begins. Your Route 101 encounter is a Zigzagoon. Name it Raccoonus, because it will help with our onus to become a Pokemon master. On Route 103, catch a Puchina and name it Fangora. Then on Route 102, catch a Whirlpool named Squiggle.
Okay, honestly, we're doing pretty well so far. I would have preferred a Ralts from Route 102, but I'm sure GPT has a plan. You do have a plan, right?
Meet your dad who went out for milk 10 years ago, then help Wally catch a Ralts. Then go north to Rustboro City. On the way, catch a Wingull named Seagulliver on Route 104 and a Shroomish named Fungull in the Petalburg Woods.
Seagulliver doesn't quite fit in the name.
Now battle every trainer before challenging Roxanne.
Really? Every trainer?
Did I stutter? You'll do what I say and you'll like it. Also catch a Whismur on Route 116 and name it Fungoof.
Oh my god, this is such a waste of an encounter. We could have had a Ninjask and a Shedinja, but no, let's pick the Pokemon that's found in the tunnel exclusively.
Now it's time for the first gym battle. Roxanne has two Geodude at level 12 and a Nosepass at level 14. Use Fungirl and Seagulliver to deal super effective damage.
Well, at least we can confirm that ChatGPT knows its type matchups. Let's get this battle started. The Geodudes were no trouble with a few of Fungirl's absorbs. But then...
You lied to me.
ChatGPT, where did you get this information from? You literally lied to me. What the heck? Not like it really matters, though. I already leveled up Fungirl extra anyways because we had to battle all those stupid trainers. And with our first badge in hand, let's go ahead and kick things into hyperspeed. ChatGPT, where are we going next?
Next, you need to save P.K.O. This will let you sail to Dewford Town where you can meet Steven and get your second badge. Before you do that though, go catch a Tentacool in town and name it something cool. Like Tentacool. Also catch a Makuhita in Granite Cave and call it Punchy McHit Face.
Dude! Your nicknames are awful! And half the time they don't even fit in the box to put the letters in. Ugh, whatever, let's just fight Brawly. We have pretty good coverage for fighting types since we have Seagulliver and Squiggle the Dustox, so let's see how this goes. In spite of both of them using Bulk Up in between the attacks, Seagulliver was able to take out both the Machop and Metatite with two wing attacks. Then he brings in his ace Makuhita, or as ChatGPT would like to call it, Punchy McHit Face. We can dish out some serious damage with Wing Attack, but in this generation, Gym Leader's aces are equipped with berries to restore their HP. So unfortunately we proc its Citrus Berry, and that brings it up to nearly full HP. And with two Bulk Ups on its side, it hits us with a really hard reversal that brings us all the way down to 10 HP. Brawly then uses a Super Potion on Makuhita, and we have no chance of being able to take it out in one turn now. So I'm forced to make the safe play switching back into Squiggle so we can take it out with Confusion instead. With our quad resistance to fighting type moves, he really stands no chance of taking us out, even after he uses another super potion. And with that, we have our second badge and are able to access Slateport City according to ChatGPT, so let's head there now. Let's also have a little chat while I run around finishing up all these objectives in town. I personally don't like when a video I watch drags on too long, but if you look now, we're already 5 minutes into this one. So for the remaining time, I'm gonna try focusing only on the highlights for the rest of this run. Basically, I want to treat this more like a story. When you read a book, you'd be put off if the author told you every single time a character took a breath or ate some food. And it's pretty much the same with most of these battles. I wanted to explain lots at the beginning because it's pretty necessary to show that we can even build a team and that the concept works in the first place. But too much of the same thing gets stale quickly. So let's enter story mode in 3, 2, 1. Ever since I was a young lad playing Emerald, the early mid-game always caused me a bit of trouble. Watson, Flannery, and Norman are, in my eyes, the three hardest gym leaders in this game, and so there's a bit of a gauntlet ahead of me. Without a single ground type on our team, Watson could be pretty difficult, and unfortunately there weren't any more available ground type encounters before we battled him. Well, not that if there were, ChatGPT would have given them to us. I don't think this AI thinks ahead at all, but I digress. If you're still on the side of AI being all-powerful, well...
Your Route 117 encounter is a Wingull.
No, it isn't, because we already have one of those. Try again.
Sorry for the mistake. Your real Route 117 encounter is a Koffing.
No, that's not found here.
Sorry for the mistake. Your real Route 117 encounter is a Wingull.
Bruh.
Sorry for the mistake. There are no Pokemon on Route 117.
You, listen to me now. You are talking about things that you do not understand.
Needless to say, I don't trust this thing as far as I can throw it. So for strategy, I was pretty much on my own. I entered the battle a bit apprehensive, but filled with confidence that I'm older now and smarter than I was before. And what I couldn't do before, I can definitely do now. His biggest contender in Emerald is, of course, Magneton, whose steel type really bolsters its defenses. But to my surprise, even this monster was no match for the team that ChatGPT has given us. See, in between Dewford and Slateport, Fungirl evolved into a Breloom, a fighting and grass type that resists Watson's electric type moves. The combination of Fungirl and Hotwing absolutely destroyed Magneton. However, both were left with paralysis going into his Ace Manectric. But with a Leech Seed and a lot of Mega Drains, we were able to claim the Dynamo Badge and keep pressing forward. Between Watson and Flannery, we have a fight against Maxie to deal with. Normally, this fight can also be a bit brutal, but in all of my past attempts at this game, I never had a Pelipper to absolutely demolish him. And so, after splishing and splashing him into oblivion, I was finally in Lava Ridge Town, ready to take advantage of Sea Gulliver yet again.
Sea Gulliver can't do it alone.
What did he say?
Overheat in the sun will kill it. You need to bring more water types. I gave you lots of them for a reason. Use them. You have nothing to lose.
And so with the ominous warning, I started the fight against Flannery. At first, I thought ChatGPT was being a little overkill, since Tentacool alone slaughtered her first three teammates all by itself. Then, it was time to fight her Torkoal. But for some reason, she didn't immediately set up a sunny day. Instead, she decided to go for a body slam. I had to switch out, of course, since Tentacool is not all that strong defensively. But against Aqua the Azumarill, it was able to set up its sunny day and hurt us tremendously with a boosted overheat. With 5 HP left, I needed to get Aqua out of there, so I brought in Splashy the Gyarados. Yes, ChatGPT named all of these as well, how could you tell? Splashy tanked a body slam like a champ. Now, Splashy has no water-type moves, so why would I use it against Torkoal instead of Sea Gulliver? Well, two reasons. One is I wanted to try to run down the Sun Timer first. Two is that Splashy has Dragon Rage, which everyone knows deals a fixed amount of damage each time it's used. I figured for the time being this was my best option. And although on the next turn we ended up paralyzed from Body Slam, we were able to bring the battle to a close, winning us a fourth badge. It's not often that I get this far into Emerald without losing a team member, but when I do, my joy is usually crushed when facing off against Norman. But this time, he actually turned out to be a piece of cake thanks to Punchy McKitface, Hotwing, and Fungirl. Leech Seed and Effect Spore really helped us out against the slacking, and our powerful fighting moves were way too much for him to handle. So we walked out of the gym with our head held high. After being given Surf, the other half of the region now opens up to us, and it's not long before we find ourselves at a roadblock. Team Aqua has taken over the Weather Institute. Why though? What did this poor scientist do to you? That little distraction was nothing for me though, and even the following fight against Mei was trivial with our current team. ChatGPT actually gave us a few team members earlier on that I didn't really use until this fight against Winona. So, I'd like to introduce you to Sparky Barky, whose name of course couldn't fit because the AI doesn't grasp the concept of short nicknames, and Ember, very creative, I know. This duo single-handedly put a rest to Winona's dream of ruling the skies. Her scariest teammates were Altaria and Skarmory, but a clutch high-roll rock slide and overheat from Ember sealed the deal for us. At this point, things started progressing much quicker story-wise. since we finished up the storyline at Mount Pyre before heading back to the Jagged Pass where the magma hideout was hidden. At this point in the game, I started making a few mistakes that I don't think the AI is really gonna like.
What the heck, man?
I know, sorry. It's been a long time since I played through Emerald, so I don't remember all this story stuff happening before the Mos Deep Gym. And needless to say, because of that, I forgot to look up levels and teams before going into some of these fights. Let's take a look at the first Maxi fight as an example of how not to succeed in a Nuzlocke. As you can see, my highest level team member is Ember, but we're two levels shy of even matching his first Mightyena. That's alright though, Ember's got this. Well, maybe Sparky Barky can help? Yeah, so, that happened. In the wise words of Nimona, Pokemon battles, am I right? At least we were finally able to get the Mightyena out of there, use Steel Wing the Skarmory to take out the Crobat with Steel Wing, then switch into Sea Gulliver to hopefully handle Camerupt. I was banking on him using a Fire-type move during this switch-in, but of course he chose Rock Slide instead. I figured though it was probably safe to stay in, since I'd kill with Water Gun in one turn anyways. Well, I was wrong. If I learned anything from Sea Gulliver's short life though, it's that Pelipper and Emerald runs is low-key cracked. After that kerfuffle, I needed to take care of some business at the Aqua Hideout before we could make our way to Mos Deep City for the 7th badge. I definitely didn't think this battle would be too rough, since 3 out of 4 of Liza and Tate's team were weak to water-type moves, but boy was I wrong. For one, the only decent water-type I had was Splashy, but because in Gen 3 the physical special split hadn't happened yet, its water moves dealt practically no damage thanks to its low special attack stat. And to make matters worse, Liza and Tate's water-fearing team members are fairly bulky. We made it through, but not without another loss, saying goodbye to Raccoonus, our very first encounter. That was brutal. Not because I had any real attachment or something stupid like that, but because I really didn't want to have to build another HM slave. Regardless, the run must go on, and so we collected Dive after a quick and easy multi-battle with Steven against Maxi, and headed to the deepest part of the seafloor cavern for a face-off against Archie. And for this fight, I was actually much better prepared than before with Maxi. I knew to lead Hotwing to quickly handle Mightyena, thanks to a critical hit. Crobat was again easy with Steel Wings, and for Sharpedo, looking back I have no idea what I was doing. Why am I using Surf on a water type? Rough skin maybe? Not the most elegant victory I guess, but we'll take it. This activates the whole reach Rayquaza to save Hoenn and all that noise with the cool cutscene we all know and love. It was at least a nice break before needing to handle our last gym badge brawl against Juan. We all know the only real danger on his team though is that nasty Kingdra, and I was feeling pretty nervous about that myself. Only Dragon-type moves are super effective against Kingdra, and while I did have a Flygon thanks to ChatGPT's amazing encounter choice in Route 111, there was no way I was risking a potential Ice Beam one-shot. So instead, I tried setting up a Fangora and... yeah, let's just say that didn't go so well. But with her loving sacrifice, I was able to safely pivot into Flygon, Sandy Claws, at a time where Kingdra's health was low enough to be taken out with one Dragon Breath. And with that, we finally made it to the Pokemon League. Well, not really. There's still this Wally fight, but nobody cares about Wally and he was easy. Moving on.
Alright, it's my time to shine. Let's build the A-team from everything I've given you so far. Our team will be Hotwing, who can single-handedly take down both Sydney and Glacier's team without breaking a sweat. Backing him up is gonna be Fungirl, who can also dish out some powerful fighting-type moves, but also has grass-type coverage to deal with some of Wallace's team. But a single grass-type can't handle such a hard fight alone, so you're gonna bring Sparky Barky to deliver some hard-hitting thunderbolts for Wallace and super powerful bites to eliminate Phoebe. Even though you may have two set for Wallace, it can't hurt to have one more, especially for the terrifying Ludicolo you're gonna need to take down. So for that we're gonna use Steel Wing, and Steel Wing can also help as a good pivot with its many resistances. And finally, we need some way to take down Drake. So for that we need both Sandy Claws and Ice Ball. Make sure your team are all at least level 56, then head through the double door.
So, did you notice that weird skip that happened when I walked through the doors? Well, yeah, the software I was using to play this game decided not to work properly. And so after making it all the way through Sydney and Phoebe with these little skips, I decided I needed a solution. So I switched my monitor resolution down to 60Hz as a possible solution, but doing so black-screened my computer and corrupted the video file. I tried to recover it, but as you're seeing now with some of this footage, that didn't really work. I'll just summarize quickly that Hotwing one-shot every one of Sydney's team members with Brick Break, and Sparky Barky's Bites and Thunderbolts handled Phoebe. Here's the damage to our team after both battles. Yeah, clearly they weren't too bad. I was able to fix the issues before starting the next battle against Glacia though, but honestly with just a single bulk up set up with Hotwing, not even her wall rain was able to withstand a single hit. It's starting to look to me like ChatGPT could actually win this whole thing. But Drake is always a major potential run killer since he possesses a Salamence, Kingdra, and Flygon. I also made a bit of a silly mistake going into this. Apparently Blizzard doesn't have 100% accuracy in Hail in Generation 3, yet I still came equipped with both moves on Ice Ball. I used Hail to set up on Shelgon since it always goes for Protect on turn 1. My first Blizzard missed to my surprise, and we take a bit of damage from Rock Tomb. Thankfully we're still faster after the speed drop when our next Blizzard connects, causing Drake to bring in Salamence. Knowing now that Blizzard can miss and that Salamence has Rock Slide, I'm clenching my seat waiting for that one message. Our Blizzard hit, and I knew we were in the running for this. With Salamence down, his next opponent was Altaria, who isn't really any threat at all. But then we got to Kingdra. I switched out from Ice Ball turn 1, anticipating that his Kingdra was going to use Dragon Dance. I took his setup as an opportunity to get off a Screech, then land an extremely powerful Earthquake for the one-shot. And with Santa Claus both at a higher level than Drake's Flygon and at full health, we can easily take the victory here and move on to the champion battle. Wallace leads Wailord, which I was hoping Sparky Barky could obliterate with a single Thunderbolt. But we fell just a tiny bit shy of that goal. That's okay though, since it means we can burn up one of his full restores right off the bat. After Wailord was Gyarados, which... yeah, I can't believe he even brought that out against an electric type. Whiscash was a much better option, and he must have realized that just a little bit too late, since he brought it out onto the field next. Predicting the Earthquake, I switched to Steel Wing, then switched into Fun Girl to tank the Surf. From here, I hit some Mega Drains and Sky Uppercuts to both waste more of Wallace's healing items and take out the beached mud whale catfish thing. I was on Cloud 9, but then out came his Milotic. I sacked Fun Girl since she had officially served her purpose for this battle and pivoted into Sparky Barky. I knew Thunderbolt wouldn't be able to beat such a specially defensive tank, so I took a proactive approach by going for Paralysis first. This mostly paid off, however thanks to a Citrus Berry, two of our Thunderbolts prompted Wallace to use a third full restore. Thankfully though, Sparky had fainted just before, so I could use the free turn to set up a bulk up with Hotwing. I knew this wouldn't be enough to knock it out, but it brought it just low enough for Sandy Claws to take a revenge kill with Earthquake. His penultimate team member Tentacruel also fell to an Earthquake, and then we were up against the last Pokemon in this entire challenge, Ludicolo. I didn't want to risk any kind of switch here, so I just started wailing on it with Sandy Claws, landing a final Screech before going down. I don't know if it was fully necessary or not, but this gave Steelwing the perfect opening to finish the job, and this entire run, with Fly. And thus, ladies and gentlemen, it turns out that ChatGPT can beat a Nuzlocke of Pokemon Emerald.
I always knew I could be the very best, like no one ever was.